اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، رب اشرح لی صدری ویسر لی امری واحلل عقدۃ من لسانی یفقہوا قولی۔ جز 11، سورہ التوبہ، ورس 94۔ دے ول پریزنٹ ٹو یو all sorts of excuses when you return to them. Say, present no excuses, we shall not believe you. Allah has already revealed to us the whole truth about you. Now Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam will keep a watch over your conduct. In the end, you will return to Him. Who knows what is hidden and what is open, and He will tell you all that you have been doing. Now this verse tells us about the people who did not go for jihad and came to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after he came back with their excuses, but Allah had revealed to him their reality on his way back. Verse 95, they will swear to you by Allah when you return to them, so that you may leave them alone. So leave them alone, they are filth. Hell shall be their abode, a punishment for their misdeeds. Verse 96, they will swear to you in order to please you, but even if you be pleased with them, Allah will never be pleased with these transgressors. Verse 97, the Arabs of the desert are the worst in disbelief and hypocrisy and are least inclined to acknowledge the limits that Allah has revealed to His Rasul. In the previous verses, the hypocrites of Medina were described. In this verse and the two next to follow, that is verse 98 and 99, the hypocrites from the Bedouins are being discussed. These people lived on the desert around the outskirts of Medina. The verse says that these hypocrites exceeded the city dwellers in disbelief and hypocrisy. The reason given is that these people generally remained ignorant and hard-hearted, as they lived far away from knowledge and the knowledgeable. Verse 98, some of the desert Arabs look upon whatever they spend in the way of Allah as a penalty and wait for some misfortune to befall you. May misfortune befall them. Allah hears all and knows all. This means that they consider zakat a penalty because they have no faith. Verse 99, but some of the desert Arabs believe in Allah and the last day and look on what they spend in the way of Allah as a means of bringing them close to Allah and receiving the prayers of the Rasul. Indeed, closer they shall be brought. Soon Allah will admit them to His mercy. Allah is forgiving, merciful. This verse refers to some of them who were not like the common lot. Verse 100, as for the first pioneers who accepted Islam from the Muhajirin and Ansar and those who followed them in good deeds, Allah is well pleased with them and they are pleased with Him. He has prepared for them gardens beneath which rivers flow, wherein they shall live forever. That is the mighty achievement. Now the verse mentions all the sincere and the true Muslims along with their relative degree of excellence. The first category is that of the Sahabas, and these were those Sahabas which were the first and the foremost in bringing Iman. And the second category were the rest of the Sahabas, Muhajirin and Ansar both. And the third category includes the Muslims who followed the footsteps of the first and the foremost precisely and perfectly in all deeds and morals. Verse 101, some of the desert Arabs around you are hypocrites, and so are some of the residents of Medina who are fanatical in their hypocrisy. You do not know them, but we know them. Soon we shall give them double punishment. Then they shall be turned to the most severe chastisement. Now we find that in the previous verses, hypocrites were mentioned whose hypocrisy stood exposed through their words and deeds. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did realize that they were hypocrites. In this verse, a different class of hypocrites is being mentioned. They were so clever that their hypocrisy remained in perfect camouflage and remained hidden from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until then. Verse 102, there are some who have confessed their sins. They have mixed records of good and bad deeds. It is quite possible that Allah may turn to them in mercy, for Allah is forgiving, merciful.
This verse mentions the fourth group that, despite being true Muslims, they did not participate in jihad because of laziness. The verse says that some had admitted their sins. Their deeds were mixed. Some of their deeds were good while others were bad. For them, there was hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may accept their repentance. Verse 103, take sadaqat from their wealth so that they may thereby be cleansed and purified, and pray for them, for your prayer will give them comfort. Allah hears all and knows all. Now the background of this verse is that some people, as mentioned a little earlier, had stayed back from the Battle of Tabuk without a valid excuse. Then out of remorse, they had tied themselves up to the pillars of the mosque. Then came the acceptance of their repentance as revealed in the previous verses, and they were released from their self-imprisonment. When this happened, they presented their entire wealth as a token of their gratitude so that it could be given out as sadaqah. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused to accept it by saying that he did not have the authority to take it. Therefore, this verse was revealed and he accepted to take one third of it as sadaqah. Verse 104, do they not know that Allah accepts repentance from his servants and takes their sadaqah? And surely Allah is the one who is the acceptor of repentance, the merciful. Verse 105, tell them, do as you will. Allah, his Rasul, and the believers will now keep a watch over your conduct. Then you shall be brought to his court, who knows the hidden and the open, and he will inform you of all that you have done. Now, the next verse, that is verse 106. The background of the verse is that there were 10 people who were those sincere Muslims, yet they did not go for jihad due to laziness. 7 out of them were the ones who punished themselves and seek repentance, which they were granted, and the remaining 3 did not admit their misconduct openly. They were boycotted by the Muslims, and later when they confessed and repented sincerely, orders were given of their pardon. Now this verse, which we are going to read, is related to them. There are yet others whose case is held in suspense for the decision of Allah. He will either punish them or turn to them in mercy, and Allah is knowledgeable, wise. Verse 107, there are others who built a mosque for mischievous motives, to spread disbelief and to disunite the believers, and an outpost for one who had made war against Allah and his Rasul before. They will indeed swear that their intentions are nothing but good, but Allah declares that they are absolute liars. Now the background of this verse is that under the leadership of Abu Amir, a Christian scholar and an enemy of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Islam, who was known for his conspiracies against Islam, the Jews of Medina, with his advice, built a mosque so that they would use it for their secret meetings and collect weapons against the Muslims. They requested Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to lead a salah there to keep their mission in disguise. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that he was going on the Battle of Tabuk and he would visit the mosque after his return. On his way back, when he camped at a place near Medina, these verses were revealed, which exposed the conspiracy of these hypocrites. And after this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered his companions to go and demolish this ill-intended mosque. From this verse, we come to know about the history of this mosque, and it is known as Masjid-e-Darrar. Verse 108. You should never stand to offer salah in it. Certainly, the mosque founded on piety from the very first day is more deserving that you should stand to offer salah in it. For in it, there are men who love to be purified, and Allah loves those who purify themselves. Now, this verse condemns the mosque built by the hypocrites, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is commanded that he should never pray in this mosque. And appreciation is given to Masjid-e-Quba, that this masjid is more deserving that you should pray in it. And then a special tribute is given to the people of Quba, that these people have the quality of keeping themselves purified, and Allah loves the purified. Verse 109, who is a better person? He who lays the foundation of his building on piety to Allah and his good pleasure, or he who lays the foundation of his building on an undetermined bank that will tumble down with him into fire of hell? Allah does not guide such wrongdoers. Again, Masjid al-Darar is condemned and Masjid al-Quba is declared blessed. Verse 110, the foundation of those who so build is never free from suspicion and shakiness in their heart until their hearts are cut to pieces. The verse says that this building of Masjid al-Darar will never give peace to their hearts, but it will create what? Doubt, raiba, which raiba is that doubt which makes you restless, so much so that this doubt, this restlessness can make their hearts break into pieces. Verse 111, indeed Allah has purchased from the believers their persons and their wealth, in return has promised them paradise. They fight in the cause of Allah and slay and are slain. This is a true promise which is binding on him, mentioned in Torah, the Injil and the Quran. And who is more true in fulfilling its promise than Allah? Rejoice therefore in the bargain which you have made, and that is a mighty achievement. This verse is in honor of the true believers. Verse 112, those who turn to Allah in repentance, serve Him, praise Him, move about in the land for His sake, make ruku and sujood, enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil, and observe the limits set by Allah. O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, proclaim the good news to such believers. Now this verse tells about the qualities of the people who have been mentioned in the previous verse, that they have indeed made a very profitable bargain. Verse 113, it is not proper for the prophets and those who believe that they should beg forgiveness for the mushrikeen, even though they be their relatives, after it has been explained to them that they are inmates of hellfire. Now the background of the verse is that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's uncle Abu Talib was dying, he tried his level best that his uncle recites the kalima, but Abu Jahl, who was also present there, categorically dissuaded him from doing so. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam swore that he would continue to seek forgiveness for his uncle unless and until Allah stops him, and then this verse was revealed. Verse 114. The background of this verse is that in case anyone has this doubt that why was Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped to seek forgiveness for his uncle when Ibrahim alaihi salam seek forgiveness for his father, the answer is that at that time Ibrahim alaihi salam did not know that his father would stick to disbelief. When this fact became certain, then he stopped asking pardon for him. The words of the verse are, Ibrahim alaihi salam prayed for his father's forgiveness only to fulfill a promise he had made to him, but when it became clear to him that he was an enemy of Allah, he disassociated himself from him. The fact is that Ibrahim was tender-hearted, forbearing. Verse 115, it is not the way of Allah to confound people after He makes clear to them what they should guard against. Surely Allah has the knowledge of everything. Verse 116. Surely it is Allah to whom belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. He gives life and causes to die. You have none besides Allah to protect or to help. Verse 117, Allah forgave the Prophet and those Muhajir and Ansar who stood by him in the time of distress when some were on the point of losing heart. He turned to them in mercy. Surely to them He is most kind, most merciful. Now, this verse refers to the seven Sahabas who tied themselves to the pillars of Masjid Nabvi and remained tied until their Tawbah was accepted. 118. He also turned in mercy to the three, the decision of whose case was deferred. So despondent were they that the earth with all its vastness and their own souls seemed close in upon them. They knew for certain that there was no refuge from Allah except in Him. Then He turned to them in mercy so that they could repent. Surely Allah is the one who is oft returning the merciful. Now this verse is about the three people who did not put up an open confession of their staying behind from the battle. These were Ka'b bin Malik, Hilal bin Umayyah and Murara bin Rabih. radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajmain. They were sincere Muslims and had given many sacrifices for Islam before. Hazrat Ka'b bin Malik narrates this whole incident, the gist of which is that he had no solid reason for abandoning jihad other than laziness. He thought he would join the Muslims en route, but unfortunately this could not be done. When he was finally presented before Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he could not bring himself to make a false excuse and told nothing but the truth, as he firmly believed that only truth could save him. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to go until Allah gave his decision of the case. People confused him and made him double-minded about inventing a false excuse, and Murara bin Rabi did not go, as this was the time of ripening of his date farm, and Hilal bin Umayyah's family had reunited at that time after being scattered for long, and he wanted to spend time with them. That's why they didn't go for jihad. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all his companions boycotted them all, and this was a time of great tension and grief and distress for them. Enemies of Islam tried to exploit the situation by inviting them to join hands, but they refused their proposals, which was full of temptations. Even their wives were stopped from staying with them, and after 50 nights the divine decree about their repentance was revealed, and all the Muslims were rejoicing and congratulating them on this great relief. Verse 119, O believers, have fear of Allah and be with those who are truthful in word and deed. Verse 120, it is not proper for the people of Medina and the Bedouin Arabs of the neighborhood to forsake the Rasul of Allah or to jeopardize his life so as to safeguard their own, because they do not suffer any thirst or hunger or any ordeal for the sake of Allah, or take any step which may provoke the unbelievers or receive an injury from an enemy, but shall be written down as a good deed on their account, for Allah does not waste the reward of the righteous. 121. Likewise, they do not spend anything for the cause of Allah, be it small or large, or cut across a valley in jihad, but it is written down to their credit so that Allah may reward them based on the best of their deeds. Verse 122, it is not proper that the believers should go forth altogether. Therefore, why not a squadron from each division stay behind so that they may obtain the understanding of deen and admonish people when they return to them so that they may refrain from un-Islamic conduct. Now the verse says that an equally important and crucial jihad is teaching religious knowledge, that a group of people will work on this front also. This too is an excellent form of jihad. A group will fight on the military front and a group will dedicate their energies for this teaching front. Verse 123, O believers, fight the unbelievers who are near to you and let them know how strong you are. You should know that Allah is on the side of the God-fearing. 124, whenever a surah is revealed, some of them ask, whose faith from among you has increased by this? Certainly the faith of the believers is increased and they do rejoice. The background of this verse is that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to have gatherings in which the Quran was recited and explained, and attending these gatherings was a sort of obligatory for all the Muslims, so much so that whoever did not attend this gathering was not considered to be a Muslim. That's how important it was. And even the hypocrites attended these gatherings in order to camouflage their hypocrisy, and they used to make fun of it by asking each other that, is it increasing your iman? Meaning that, has this, you know, the speech of this gathering, has it moved your heart? This was their way of mocking. But the case of a mu'min is different. His iman actually increases in such gatherings. 125, as for those whose heart contain malice, it will add filth to their existing filth, and they will die while they are still unbelievers. Verse 126, do they not see that they are tested every year once or twice, yet they neither repent nor learn a lesson from this? The indication here is towards the hypocrites that Allah inflicts them with problems such as, for example, famines and diseases again and again, yet they do not analyze their deeds and do not take heed and they do not repent. Verse 127, whenever a surah is revealed, they look at each other as if to ask, is anyone watching? Then they silently slip away. Allah has diverted their hearts, for they are a people who do not want to understand. Now the problem with these people was that it's not that they couldn't understand. The problem was that they didn't want to understand. And when a person is bent upon denial, then it is very hard to teach that person. Verse 128, now there has come to you a Rasul from among yourselves, the one who grieves at your loss and who is excessively anxious for your success in both worlds, and who is compassionate and merciful towards the believers. 129, now if they turn away from you, say Allah is all sufficient for me. There is no God but Him. In Him I have put my trust. He is the Rabb of the mighty throne. Hazrat Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever reads this dua 7 times morning and evening, Allah will be enough for him in all his important matters. Surah Yunus, verse 1, Alif Lam Ra. Verse 2, does it seem strange to the people that we revealed our will to a man from among themselves, saying, warn mankind and give the good news to the believers that they are on sound footing with their Rabb? The disbelievers say, this man is indeed an obvious magician. Verse 3, the fact is that your Rabb is the same Allah who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and then established himself on the throne in a manner that suits his majesty and is directing the affairs of the universe. None can intercede for you except the one who receives his permission. This is Allah your Rabb, so worship him. Will you not receive admonition? Now this means that even after realizing the majesty of Allah, you are still not ready for submission. Verse 4, to him you shall all return. Allah's promise is true. He is the one who originates the process of creation and repeat it, so that he may justly reward those who believed in him and did righteous deeds. As for those who disbelieved, they shall have boiling fluids to drink and shall undergo a painful punishment because they rejected the truth. The verse says that don't forget that eventually you have to go back to him, and this promise of Allah is true. And what is the proof that this promise is true? That if Allah can create you once, then he has all the power to create you a second time. Verse 5, he is the one who gave the sun its brightness and the moon its light, established her phases, that you may learn to compute the years and other such counts. Allah created them only to manifest the truth. He has spelled out his revelations for people who want to understand. Verse 6, indeed, in the alteration of the night and the day and what Allah has created in the heavens and the earth, there are signs for those who are God-fearing. Verse 7, as for those who do not hope to meet us on the day of judgment, being well pleased and satisfied with this worldly life, and those who give no heed to our revelations. Verse 8, they shall have the fire as their abode because of what they had earned. Verse 9, in fact, those who believe in the truth which is revealed in this book and do good deeds, their Rabb will guide them because of their faith, and rivers will flow beneath their feet in the gardens of bliss. Verse 10, glory to you, O Allah. Their greetings therein will be, peace be upon you, and their closing remarks will be, all praises are for Allah alone, the Rabb of the worlds. Now this verse refers to the people of Jannah, and this is what they would be saying to each other in Jannah. Verse 11, if Allah were to hasten the punishment for the evil as they hasten in asking good of this world, then the respite given to the people would have been terminated. But this is not our way. We leave those people alone who do not entertain the hope of meeting us to blunder about in their rebellion. Now this means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hastens to give the good that people ask for, but does not respond to the evil they ask for. And in case if he did, then this world would come to an end. Verse 12, whenever affliction touches a man, he prays to us, whether lying down on his side, sitting or standing, but as soon as we relieve his affliction, he walks away as if he had never prayed to us for removing that affliction which touched him. Thus the foul deeds which they do are made fair seeming to the transgressors. Now in this verse, the shallow nature of man is exposed, that when he is in a crisis, he begs and cries before Allah. But once this crisis is over, he forgets all about. Verse 13, we have destroyed generations before your time when they adopted unjust attitudes. Their rasuls came to them with clear signs, but they would not believe. Thus do we recompense criminals. 14, then we made you their successors in the land so that we may observe how you would conduct yourself. Verse 15, when our clear revelations are recited to them, those who entertain no hope of meeting us say to you, bring us a Quran different than this or make some changes in it. O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell them, it is not possible for me to change it myself. I follow only what is revealed to me. Indeed, I cannot disobey my Rabb, for I fear the punishment of a mighty day. Verse 16, say, if Allah wanted otherwise, I would not have made you aware of it. Then I have lived among you for years before it. Have you then no sense? Verse 17, say, who can be more unjust than the one who himself forges a lie, then ascribes it to Allah or falsifies his real revelation? Verse 18, they worship other deities besides Allah, who can neither harm them nor benefit them. And they say, these are our intercessors with Allah. O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say to them, are you informing Allah of what he knows to exist, neither in the heavens nor on the earth? Glory to him, he is far above from having the partners they ascribe to him. Verse 19, mankind was once just one nation. Later on, they became divided through inventing different creeds. If your Rabb had not already given his word, the matters in which they differed would have certainly been decided. Now, it means that Allah had already decided that Allah will remain in disguise. He will be behind the veil and people will recognize him with his signs. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was exposed directly, then there would have been no difference of opinion between anyone. Verse 20, in regards to their saying, why has not a sign been sent down to him from his Rabb? Tell them, Allah alone has the knowledge of the unseen. Wait if you will, I too shall wait with you. Now this is an answer to the people of Makkah who kept on asking for ever new miracles. Verse 21, when we show mercy to mankind after some calamity had afflicted them, they begin to plot against our revelations. Tell them, Allah is more swift in plotting than you. This means that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes your state from bad times to good times, then you forget all the promises you made during those hard times. Verse 22, he is the one who enables you to travel through the land and by the sea until when you are on board a ship, as the ship sails with a favorable wind and they feel happy about it. But when there comes a stormy wind and the waves reach them from all sides and they think they are being overwhelmed, then they pray to Allah with their sincere devotion, saying, if you deliver us from this, we shall become your true thankful devotees. An incident is quoted as the background of this verse. It says that when Makkah was conquered, Ikrimah bin Abu Jahl ran from there and he took a ship for that purpose. On his way, he was caught by a storm. The person who was rowing the ship said to him that call Allah. At that moment, Ikrimah thought to himself that it is only Allah, if it is only Allah who can save one in water, then who saves you on the land? Then he thought that what is the purpose behind invoking all the false gods, the devis and devatas? His eyes were opened at that moment. He saw and recognized the truth at that very moment. And then with all his heart, he prayed to Allah that Allah, if you take me out safely from this storm, then I will become a Muslim. And he was saved by Allah's will and mercy. And then he went back to Makkah and accepted Islam. Verse 23, yet when we deliver them, behold, the same people become unjustly rebellious in the land. O mankind, your rebellion is against your own souls, the transitory player of this world. In the end, you have to return to us. Then we shall inform you of what you have done. Verse 24, the example of this worldly life is like water which we send down from the sky. It mingles with the soil and produces vegetation which becomes the food for men and animals. Then at that very time when the crops are ripened and the land looks attractive, the people to whom it belongs think that they are able to cultivate it, and there comes our scourge upon it by night or in the broad day, and we mow it down thoroughly as if nothing existed there yesterday. Thus do we spell out our signs for those who are thoughtful. Now this means that everything related to this dunya is transitory. Verse 25, Allah invites you to the home of peace and guides whom He pleases to the right way. Now, right after mentioning the temporary nature of this world, Allah reminds us of the everlasting bliss of the Akhirah. Verse 26, those who do good deeds shall have a good reward and even more than they deserve. Neither blackness nor disgrace shall cover their faces. They will be the inhabitants of paradise. They will live therein forever. Verse 27, as for those who have done evil deeds, they will be rewarded with like evil. Disgrace will cover them. They shall have none to protect them from Allah, as if their faces have been covered with patches of the dense darkness of night. They will become the inmates of the fire. They will live therein forever. Verse 28, on the day when we shall gather them all together, we shall say to those who committed shirk, stay where you are. You are those whom you set as partners with us. We will separate them from one another. Then the shuraka will say, it was not us that you worship. Verse 29, Allah is an all-sufficient witness between you and us. We were quite unaware of your worship. Verse 30, thereupon every soul shall know what it had sent forth, as they will be brought towards the court of Allah. Their true patron and their invented falsehood will leave them in the lurch.
وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين